Very happy to introduce Klaus Kefferpoets from the Augsburg University of Applied Research. And he's from the Cooperative Control Lab that has been existing since 2019. And he'll be also be helped by his student assistants from the same lab as well, doing the master at the same university, Thomas, Simon, and Christos. And they're going to talk about cooperative coordination, navigation, bit of position estimation. So it's going to be very excited to hear all of that. So the floor is yours, Klaus.
Yeah, thanks for that. So now you will hopefully see the PDF presentation. I hope actually that it's working for you. Thanks also on behalf of the Cooperative Control Lab for this opportunity to introduce ourselves in the CrazyFly community. As Kimberly already mentioned, we are interested in the development and application of algorithms in the field of decentralized multi-agent systems. And we are using the CrazyFly as a primary hardware demonstrator. Yeah, we would like to present some insights into our current projects we are pursuing currently. And we will be very happy to also share and publish our results. However, I'm still waiting on the website to get launched. So maybe it's a good idea to look around for the Cooperative Control Lab in a month or two. And hopefully you'll find us. Most recent presentation of what we are currently doing. The outline for today is that after this quite short introduction, there will be a first part where Thomas, Christos, and Simon will provide some insights into their current projects. So first of all, Thomas will tell us something about the cooperative path planning approach he's currently working on. Then Christos will refer to the decentralized communication scheme he's working on for the CrazyFlies. And then there will be a short presentation by Simon, who did first steps towards exploration and mapping, which we would also like to extend to a cooperative approach. You might already know or notice that these first topics of path planning and exploration and mapping have strong relations to CrazyFly positioning. And that's what I would like refer to in the second part of this presentation. And I would like to introduce an alternate navigation algorithm primarily developed for the local positioning system. So that would be the second part after our 5-minute break. So now I'd like to hand over to Thomas to tell us something about his cooperative path planner.
So I'm Thomas, hello, and I'd like to give you today a short overview of our implementation of our path planning algorithm. So it gives the CrazyFlies or multiple CrazyFlies the ability to maneuver through a constrained environment without colliding with each other. We pursued a decentralized and cooperative approach based on the closed loop, rapidly exploring random tree for the path planning part, and the merit-based token passing coordination strategy for the cooperative part. I think the main challenge here was to implement this path planner on the CrazyFly hardware, which is limited in means of computational power and available memory. Also, what's important is that this approach requires knowledge of the flight area and its constraints, but this will be part of Simon's work. The path planner itself is executed individually on every CrazyFly, and it's computing a path from a start node, its current position, for example, and a goal position that is given. For the purpose, we use the rapidly exploring random tree. And I think it's this slide. So starting from our current position, which is the root node of the tree, randomly points are generated in a predefined flying area. And for every of these points, the nearest node in the tree is determined, and an attempt is made to mate to make a direct connection to it. So if no obstacles or team paths lie in between, the node is added to the tree. So in this way, the tree grows until the goal position can be reached. And well, the path that is extracted from the tree has normally more nodes than necessary. So in a next step, path optimization algorithm tries to remove all these unnecessary nodes and also moves the nodes that are still in this path in a way that it shortens the whole path. But often, even after this optimization step, the path might not be the optimal one. So this is why the planning process is repeated continuously while flying towards the goal, and we permanently search for a better path. So since we operate in a flying area with multiple crazy flies, each path and each change to a path has to be distributed to the whole team, and it has to be coordinated with the whole team. So this requires a swarm of agents that are fully connected with each other, and they have the ability, or they need to have the ability, to exchange data directly. A completely decentralized communication strategy is currently developed by Christos, and hopefully will be soon merged with the Path Planner. As for now, and as for the development process, we decided to use the what we call pseudo-decentralized communication, meaning we have a client on a computer, and all the packets get routed through this client, and they get distributed to the corresponding team members. And this is all done via the CRTP packets, the Crazy Real-Time Protocol. And all the related path planner data is packed into our multi-agent packet, which consists of a 3-byte header, including the sender ID, destination ID, and the message type, and then also leaving 27 bytes for the payload. The coordination procedure itself can be divided into two steps. The first step is on initialization of the whole team. When the crazy fly connects to each other, a token holder is randomly set, and it's this current token holder that is responsible to collect all the bits of the crazy flies. So what is a bit? A bit represents the path improvement, meaning this is the difference between the current path length and the newly computed path length, or if it's the initial path, it's the complete path length. In the second step, the current token holder evaluates all the submitted bits, and he passes the token to the next, to the winner agent. And this allows the new token holder to start its path, to adapt its newly computed path, and it broadcasts this path information to the whole team, so they can update their constraints.
There's a little bit of audio problems going on. So I don't know if anybody is Christos or somebody has their microphone in the same room on as well. No. Ah, okay. Yes, then okay. Please continue.
Okay, so the advantage of this strategy is that there is no fixed order in which the agents update their paths, but it always favors the agent that benefits the most, and therefore increasing the overall team performance. The integration of this whole path planner can be divided into three parts. So we have the path planner itself with the rapidly exploring random tree, the path optimization, and all the associated feasibility tests. It runs with the lowest priority and consumes a lot of computational power, but it has no real-time requirements. The communication and coordination is done in a separate task and is based on the external information and the current path planner status. And all the messages are sent via the Crazy Real-Time protocol. The path controller is connected via the commander module to the rest of the firmware. And with the path information and the current position of the CrazyFly, it generates the velocity commands for the CrazyFly. And now I'd like to show you a short video. And there we can see the real-time, the rapidly exploring random tree and the cooperative path planner in action. So. Okay. Okay. Is this all full? No. Kann man das besser machen?
Weiß ich nicht.
Okay, okay, I think you can see the video. I don't think it's in full screen.
Ah, okay. Could you restart your screen share because it was still on 5 frames per second. But if you go to close your screen share and start up again, it should be faster.
All right. Okay, so I'm starting the video again. It's not very long, but okay. So here at the beginning, we can see our graphical user interface for interacting with the CrazyFly. And in the center is what we call the interactive map. It shows our current flying area, the connected CrazyFlies. And we can also set the goal position by clicking on the respective point in the map. So what you can see here is the CrazyFly flying. It's following the green path. And all the red lines and red dots is the rapidly exploring random tree, constantly searching for a path. Okay, and as you when you look closely, you can see that it's not the current position where it starts, but it's always a bit ahead of the CrazyFly. Okay, and now in this scenario, we have 3 crazy flies and a little obstacle course in our laboratory. Again, the user interface. So I'm setting the goal positions manually through clicking into the map and then starting the path planner. So I tried to draw the path into the video. And as you can see, the paths change when a shorter path has been found. Okay, what you can also see is that this transition from one path to the other path isn't very smooth in most cases. So I have to say this is still work in progress and there are some issues and we are working on them. Okay. Okay, but all in all, we have the possibility for the crazy flies to maneuver through this obstacle course. And well, there is still room for further improvement concerning or with regard to the algorithm or the efficiency of the code itself. But they all arrive. Okay, I think that is enough. Okay, so well, thanks for your attention. And this was the short overview of our path planner.
Okay. Hello together.
My name is Christos, and I'm gonna switch quick to the PowerPoint presentation again. I hope everyone can see it. Can everyone see the presentation again?
I can see your slides, yeah, and your videos also on.
Very
Thanks.
Good. Hello together again. My name is Christos, and today I'm going to present you our approach on decentralized communication, which we used for the, which we used for the cooperative path planning, which Thomas presented before a minute ago. Exactly. So the challenge that we had with the cooperative path planning was that we needed for the crazy flies to be able to communicate with each other in a unicast manner, which wasn't provided. And also this should be done in a decentralized manner. So the requirements that we had for such a communication was that the crazy flies should be able to communicate with each other without the involvement of a central station, in our case our branch station. So but they should still be possible to communicate with a ground station, which is all, of course, not a must, but they should this should be done for operation control, monitoring and logging. So here on the up on the right side of the slide, one can see the current network that's provided from BitCrazy. So we have our grand station with the crazy radio PR dongle, which communicates with the crazy flies and controls all the communications. However, what we needed for the cooperative path planning is illustrated by the networks below. This means that we have a network with some crazy flies that are fully connected with each other, meaning that each crazy fly should be able to communicate with all other crazy flies in the network, or and also with the ground station or not. Here arises to the question, how do we realize such a communication protocol? Our first approach was to use to implement a communication protocol relying on a message collision avoidance strategy. For example, the carrier sends multiple access collision avoidance. But we quickly realized that this wasn't an option for us because of the hidden node problem, which caused a lot of message collisions, and the crazy flies weren't anymore able to communicate with each other in a real manner. So after this failed attempt, we came up with the idea of using a token passing strategy. What that means is that we have on the right side, one can see the network. So this means that we have a network of multiple nodes, or in this case, crazy flies. This network has a ring topology. This is a virtual ring topology, and there is a token. This token then circulates with high frequency the whole network, and whenever a crazy fly is in possession of this token, it then can transmit its data, but only then. This means that we don't have any more data collisions. Another reason why we use this token passing approach is because it is in scope decentralized, meaning that we don't need a central node to handle the communication, also, all the nodes in the network are equal. We don't have data collisions, as mentioned before, because only one node can communicate at a time. This means that we don't also have the hidden node problem. It's ideal for some applications because the communication is provided all the time. Exactly. It fulfills also real-time conditions, and the network can also be dynamically changed. Although this strategy resolved a lot of issues that we had with another approach, it had its own challenges. One challenge that we had was the token handling. We needed to ensure that that the token is transmitted between the nodes successfully. So it means that the token should not be lost or duplicated. We solved this issue by employing timers and additional messages. And another issue that we had was to the data handling. We needed to ensure that also the data was transmitted successfully. And to solve this, we employed an acknowledgement frame and some internal flags that make a successful transmission. And another big challenge was to make the network dynamic. This means that CrazyFly should be able to auto-insert in the network and also auto-disconnect. The idea for an auto-insertion is for the nodes that are currently in an active network to search periodically for new nodes, and for the auto disconnect, there are two cases that we have. One is when the node knows when to disconnect, then it should signal the others that it wants to disconnect. And another case is when there is a failure in the CrazyFly, for example, or it's out of reach. In this case, then this node will be auto thrown from the network because it will fail to acknowledge the frames. The next step was to come up with an idea on how to integrate this into the CrazyFly ecosystem. So the idea there was that we use the existing Crazy real-time protocol, the ZTP, and change its link layer from the enhanced shock buster to the token passing protocol. On the right side, one can see the ZTP in the three layers that it's implemented, and the one that we need to change is the link layer from the ESP to the token passing. With this approach, this means that we will have all the ZTP applications also with the token passing approach. Exactly. Now I would like also to show some implementations detail, how we implemented this. A big change that we needed to do was to replace the Crazy Radio Pair dongle with an NRF5 ones developer kit because of compatibility issues. And another thing that we needed to do is to expand the CrazyFly Python library API with a new ZTP driver for this bot. And also a thing that we also needed is that the bot should be able to communicate with our Python ground station. For this, we use the most straightforward thing that we had in our hands. And this was the COM port of the NRF-Infines chip. And for this, we use also the syslink protocol that is also implemented in the CrazyFly. And now, and on the side of the CrazyFly, we needed to do also some adjustments. First and most was the NRF-Infine 5.1 firmware. There, we needed to do some modifications. We needed to use the token passing protocol to implement it there instead of the ESP, the enhanced shock passer. And in the CrazyFly firmware, we need also to modify the radio link layer. This was some implementations detail. Now this communication approach is still in development. As we are improving the implementation and adding some new features, we also plan in the new future to make a performance evaluation and to find out also the limitations of this protocol. It's also to plan, as Thomas mentioned, to integrate this with the cooperative path planning, Although here I would like also to mention that this was already successful in my bachelor thesis, where I also demonstrated with a previous version of the cooperative path planner that is doable. And at last, I would like also to mention that I am more than happy to share the source code for everything that you see in the implementations detail, as we keep everything with open source. And yes, here I would like to thank you for your attention. And I think Simon is the next presenter here.
Hello everyone. I'm Simon, and I've been working on autonomous exploration and mapping on my bachelor thesis last semester, and I'm glad to tell you something about it now. Exploration and mapping. Exploration and mapping means exploring an unknown environment and collecting data about it and compiling this data into a map. This topic was inspired by or motivated by the path planning, which Thomas has already told us about. In the path planning, the agents, which we see here, already know everything about the environment and the obstacles they have to avoid. So my topic was to get this information in terms of obstacle data and obstacle parameters. The goal in the long term would be to explore an environment autonomously with a swarm of crazy flies, which are equipped with sensor decks. To be more precise, the Multiranger deck, which is a laser distance sensor. And with the data, the swarm would detect a map could be developed, which every agent can access to. And we would also like to use the AI deck and implement this application on it, so we could overcome the reduced compiling capacity of the SDM microprocessor. So the first step was to develop an autonomous exploration and mapping application for a single crazy fly, and supported by a positioning system like the Lighthouse deck or the LPS deck. In order to extract the obstacle coordinates from the measured data, to get things to know about the unknown environment, you would probably use a state-of-the-art SLAM method, which is unfortunately not feasible for the crazy fly due to the low computational resources. On the other hand, the swarm gradient back algorithm, which was developed by Kimberly, has already proved in an impressive way that exploration with crazy flies is possible. However, this process did not output a map while still flying. So to benefit from the AI deck, we decided also to employ a machine learning approach. And this is also a step where we could use the AI deck. So to sum it up, the approach was to use the wall following algorithm from the swarm gradient back algorithm for the exploration, and to send the multi-ranger measurements and the navigation data to an external computation unit where the measurements would be registered in a global map and where the machine learning algorithm would extract the obstacle information from the measurement data. And we also assumed to reduce the complexity of a real world environment, that there are only rectangular obstacles in a rectangular shape. So now a few words to the hardware and the architecture. I used CrazyFly 2.1 with the built-in BitCraze firmware and the modified wall following algorithm based on the SGBA algorithm, which is also available on the BitCraze GitHub repository. The wall following algorithm works with the input from the laser distance sensor, and these distances are also transferred to the to the external computation unit by the crazy radio, together with the position and attitudes from the crazy fly, which can be determined by the sweep angle measurements from the lighthouse stack or from the lighthouse positioning system. We also use the local positioning system for comparison, but Klaus will say a few words to this later. I will try to hurry up a little bit by the machine learning algorithms too, so we do not run out of time. we used convolutional neural networks to extract the obstacle parameter, which mean position, length, and width from the point cloud measurements. And this approach is actually inspired by an AI application from the image processing. To sum it up, what do we do is we put an input image into several convolution and pooling layers. This is where the feature extraction takes place. And the output from these layers is serves as the input for two other layers or two other small networks, which are fully connected layers, and they are known from most machine learning applications. And what this convolutional neural network does is it outputs localization and a classification output. So in this case, this is a little example. If you input if you train the network and input an image with a single digit, it would output the localization, so which is shown with the red frame here, and classification, so it will tell you it is the digit number 3. In context of my work, we first implemented it on the ground station, but the long-term objective is to implement it on the AI deck in order to provide a decentralized application with Swarm as a swarm. One problem you get when you use convolutional neural networks for this application is that you only can input that the network can only output one classification and one localization prediction for every input you give it. So this is a little example. If you have this measurement here, the black dots is the multi-ranger data in a 2D print, and we would like to get the obstacle position, which is here marked in red, and we would feed it to the network. It would probably give you one large obstacle, which would probably be wrong. So what we do is we separate the data into smaller input images and let the network run over all these images and collect the classification and localization output. And in the end, we combine all this together to obstacles like this. The convolutional neural network has to be trained. And therefore, we generated artificial training data. This is a small excerpt from this training data. So we generated some random obstacles the network should predict, and added some artificial noise and moved it a little around. Okay, so after everything was implemented on the CrazyFly, the algorithm had to be tested, of course. So what you see here is a small setup in the lab with a few walls and additional obstacles. These are depicted with the black lines here on the right. And the measurements are these gray crosses, and the flight path is depicted in red. So you see this was a single round, and it almost covered the whole surrounding. For a better illustration, we also provided a short video. I would like to share it with you in the end, so we don't lose too much time. So let's just talk about these for a second. We see a very sufficient recording of the environment, but if you look closer, there are some some corners that are weakly covered, which leads to a problem. So the neural network does not get that there's also an obstacle in this way. And there are also some outliers all around the map, and especially at sharp edges from obstacles. And this leads to enlarged obstacles, which you see here in blue. And this, we do not want this actually. So to improve the reliability and the safety of the algorithm, it has to be optimized. So we could use it for decentralized and for the decentralized application. And you could think about a gradient which shows the crazy fly to explore especially weakly covered areas like these corners. And finally, it would be nice to implement it all on the AI deck, so we could use it in a swarm application. Okay, that's it from my side.
There was a question about from Nishant. I'm probably pronouncing the name completely wrong. I apologize for that. But he was wondering what was the motivation for using the RRT planner instead of like using a star, for example, which outputs optimal paths. So like, what is the motivation why you guys use the rapid random trees for the exploration? That's perhaps a question for the first speaker, I think, right, Thomas?
Yeah, Christos or Thomas?
Hello. Our idea was at first to implement the rapidly exploring random tree in a very basic version. So our main goal was that it was running on the crazy fly with its limitations concerning the computational power. So we are aware there are a lot of different versions of the RRT, and well, we found this cooperative one, and I think this was the first try, I guess you can say.
Yeah, there's another motivation why using these RRT approaches, because we have to account for a dynamically changing environment. At least it's the long-time goal to extend the approach towards dynamically changing environments. And even with this implementation, we have to take into account the passes of the other agent in the scenario. So that's also something which would complicate things for a star, for example.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it seems that there's actually quite a lot of questions, and we kind of want to speed up on time. So I would recommend Thomas, Christos, and Simon to answer the rest of the questions, and number 2 and 3 from Nishant, and perhaps also from Rick in the chat. so that Klaus can already get started on his talk. Just to keep an eye on time, I'm giving you a bit of extra time due to the technical difficulties in the beginning, but we also want to have to meet the speakers at the end of this. So let's continue. Is that okay by you guys?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, let's do that. All right. So Klaus, you can share your screen if you want.
Yeah. So I hope you're seeing my screen. I think I have to restart my camera again and proceed towards my starting point. So yeah, for the second part of this presentation, I thought of presenting something concerning navigation. You might already have inferred from the previous presentation that navigation is of crucial importance when working with multi-agent systems. So for our cooperative path planner, it's quite important that the crazy fly is able to follow the previously planned trajectories as closely as possible. And every positional error has to be accounted for by introducing additional conservativeness. So enlarging a security margin around the crazy fly to ensure that there are no collisions with obstacles or with other crazy flies moving around in the same area. If you consider the topic of exploration and mapping, things become, at least from my point of view, even more impressive. So what you're seeing on the top right side of this slide is the ground truth map of obstacles in black in our lab. And then you see the LiDAR measurements obtained using the multi-ranger deck. And on the one side, you see what's happening if you perform this experiment, moving the crazy fly around, having the Lighthouse deck attached. And Lighthouse is providing positional accuracies of comparably high quality, so in the regime of 2 to 5 centimeters, and you'll see that you get quite a nice approximation of your obstacle area. In contrast, if you're relying on the local positioning system with an additional data fusion with the flow deck, you see that this performance is dramatically reduced. So there's lots of uncertainty in the LiDAR measurements concerning their relation to the actual arrangements of obstacles in the lab, which will definitely complicate things. And it will become even more severe if you consider combining this data obtained from multiple crazy flies having their own navigational errors. So what could you do about it? The first idea would be just rely on Lighthouse, because Lighthouse seems to have a very high navigational accuracy. However, thinking of our objective to fly within those obstacle canyons, there might be a problem guaranteeing that there's always a direct line of sight contact with regard to the Lighthouse base stations. That's the reason why we are still quite interested in improving the local positioning system. It does not have this necessity of guaranteeing direct line of sight contact, but its localization accuracy is far beyond the Lighthouse system. We can enhance that using additional flow deck measurements, so perform data fusion here, but there's still room for improvement. So this was the motivation to look for a concept which is cooperative navigation, which I would like to refer to in the very end of my part. So to get things ready to be able to implement something like cooperative navigation, we found that the existing filter approach implemented in the BitCraze firmware is not ideally suited for extending it towards a cooperative navigation scenario. So we looked for a different approach, and we found one which is stated in this paper of SOLA, combining something which is called a strap-down navigation with an extended Kalman filter approach. So aim of the strapdown navigation part is basically performing a time integration procedure on the gyroscope and accelerometer measurements. But unfortunately, considering the quality of the CrazyFly sensors, this will surely lead to a drift in the estimated navigational state. And this would render any attempt to fly autonomously would be rendered impossible. And to correct the strapdown solution, there's an error state extended Kalman filter, which is suggested in this implementation. And its purpose is to estimate the error state whenever you receive additional data from your aiding sensors, which could be the local positioning system or the flow deck. There are a few additional benefits with this implementation. There's no wind-free assumption. So if you consider to build your CrazyFly Bolt-based outdoor drone, it might be an advantage to use this approach. And in addition, there are no drone-specific parameters aside the sensor covariances, which have to be adapted. So it should be very easy to transfer this filter, for example, on a customized-based drone relying on the Bolt. However, it's not just implementing this approach, because having a closer look on the extended Kalman filter, which is suited for estimating the state of a nonlinear stochastic system, we see that the extended Kalman filter tries to use an approximation by means of computing Jacobians within the prediction and the measurement update steps of the algorithm. And this can be a bit prohibitive, considering the amount of nonlinearity we have in the system. And this becomes especially visible considering the measurement equation for the local positioning system, which we are using in the TDOA3 mode, meaning that our anchors are performing time of arrival measurements. The CrazyFlies are listening passively to this communication, and what they receive is, in the end, a difference of distances with regard to two of these anchor positions. Yeah, just for a first look on the equation, you see that it's containing quite a lot of degree of nonlinearity. There's a square root function and some of squares terms here. So just computing just handling this nonlinear equation by computing Jacobians might introduce linearization errors. And those errors are then processed into the Kalman gain. So these errors lead to an over or underestimate of the measurement covariances and cross correlations within the filter. And those affect the Kalman gain. And finally, in the update step, those errors also affect the estimated state of your filter. There are also some equations provided for the flow deck, which is our second use case, or the second aiding sensor we'd like to fuse in the filter. So for one hand, there is this time of flight sensor measuring the distance to the ground. And the second sensor is the optical flow measurement. And the second one also contains some degree of nonlinearity. So also for this one, it might be beneficial to come up with an alternate solution for avoiding the computation of Jacobian matrices. Yeah, looking around, there's a quite common approach to handle such things, which is the unscented filter, which does not rely on approximation or computing of Jacobian matrices, but instead computes so-called sigma points to better approximate the nonlinear transformations. So the small figure on the right side gives you an impression. So consider there's a Gaussian-shaped distribution initially, which can be described in terms of its mean and its covariance. Then you could use Monte Carlo sampling to get a quite accurate representation of its transformed version, which is indicated on the right side. And also for this transformed version, you'll find you are able to compute a mean and a covariance. And in the best case, you'd like your filter to also come up with the same mean and the same covariance. However, using an extended Kalman filter and introducing those Jacobians and a linear transformation, you will see that there's some deviation between the estimated mean and the covariance when they are derived based on the extended Kalman filter approach. So a somehow intermediate solution between the Monte Carlo sampling, which won't be feasible on the CrazyFly hardware, and the extended Kalman filter, the uncentered filter computes deterministically chosen sigma points, and you can take these sigma points, apply the nonlinear transformation directly to those points. Then you get your transformed set of points, and you will be able to extract another mean and a covariance, and one can show that the approximation quality is increased in comparison to the extended Kalman filter. So that's basically the final approach. So we combined the strategy proposed by Solar, but replaced the extended Kalman filter by the uncentered filter. We did not only consider the local positioning measurements, we also fuse flow deck measurements to enhance the navigation accuracy, but there's a special issue when using the flow deck. Maybe some of you might already have noticed this issue, because when you're trying to fly over obstacles or other crazy flies, the time of flight measurement of the flow deck distance sensor is affected. And this will cause undesired height jumps in the altitude of your crazy fly, which is something we want to avoid. And to this end, we used a very straightforward outlier detection method relying on the measurement covariance of computed by the uncentered filter. Yeah, before showing some results, let's refer to the measurement setup. Because when you start developing navigation algorithms, you need some ability to get ground truth data for parameter tuning and, of course, also for quantitative evaluation afterwards. And to this end, we use the Lighthouse system, but we are not relying on the sweep angular measurement method, but on the crossing beam method, which provides an ability to derive the CrazyFly position without the need of using data in a filter, because that is something which we have to avoid, of course, because otherwise we cannot judge our new implementation. So the setup in the lab is depicted here. You have your local positioning anchors, at least four of them. The other four are placed on the opposite wall. And then there is one of our two Lighthouse base stations installed. The other one is right behind the camera. And luckily we have the same setting twice, which gives us lots of possibilities during the Corona period, because for me it means that I had the opportunity to also build up an improvised Corona lab here at home. So I was able to carry out experiments also without access to the university. The CrazyFly itself is now equipped with a modified LPS deck, thanks to BitCraze. So it's modified in the sense that there's a switch of the serial port, because the usual serial port connection is used by the Lighthouse deck and not available for LPS anymore. Then you attach a Lighthouse deck on top of your CrazyFly. And on the bottom side, we attach the LPS deck such that we are able to get ground truth data out of the Lighthouse deck for comparison. There's a last step before your quantitative evaluation. You have to make sure that the Lighthouse and the LPS coordinates frames are well aligned. And even if you try very hard to get things aligned, there will still be some errors between these two, and they are estimated by an approach stated in this quite old paper of Arun. Yeah, let's discuss some of the results. And I think before talking too much about this slide, I just show a video. So just give me a second. Yeah, hopefully you're seeing the video now. Basically, the video was recorded for a submission to the ICRA recently. And due to the fact that Bitcrace supported us quite nicely setting up the Lighthouse system, we did this publication together. Hopefully, it will also be accepted. And in this video, you see two performance evaluations. The first one is a comparison of the standard firmware filter against the newly introduced error state uncentered Kalman filter approach, where both filters are just relying on their IMU data. The local positioning data, which is named UWB here, since it's relying on an ultra wideband signal. And we also take into account the barometer measurements. The experiment was following a rectangular shaped reference trajectory with a constant attitude, which is somehow motivated by the application of the cooperative path planner. Now you see those two crazy flies. You will get an overlay such that you can judge the quality in one video. The red one is the one which is running the error state uncentered filter, so the new filter. And you see its ability to follow a trajectory compared to the standard firmware implementation. This is the first perspective. You get another one, which is taken from our surveillance camera. So there's also a top view, which hopefully indicates that the improvement is not just concerning altitude stability, but also concerning the position estimated in the horizontal plane, especially in this region here. You see that the blue one, so the standard filter, is experiencing some distractions from the reference trajectory. So when you judge things quantitatively, you will find that the error state uncentered filter is indeed about 20% better in terms of its ability to follow these reference trajectories compared to the standard implementation. And this can be enhanced using additional flow deck data. But as already stated a few seconds ago, we would like to avoid these undesired positional jumps because we would like to be able to fly over obstacles. And obstacles for us could mean flying over other crazy fly team members, for example, in the application of the cooperative path planning. So what you see now is again a comparison of the standard filter against the error state and standard filter, where the latter also incorporates an outlier rejection method. And both crazy flies are fusing LPS data and additional flow deck data. And the experiment is flying over ground obstacle. So you see these boxes, and you see what's usually happening flying with the standard filter. And you see that this quite straightforward outlier rejection method is able to avoid such phenomena. And it would also work if you are not operating in an LPS environment, but just relying purely on your flow deck. You just have to make sure that you do not hover over an obstacle for a longer period of time. Yeah, coming back to the slides. So as I already mentioned, there's a contribution to ICRA. Hopefully it will become accepted. Then you would also find the paper. But anyway, you are able to evaluate yourselves. So you just have to navigate through this GitHub repository And you could check out the aerostate uncentered Kalman filter approach there. Just be aware that you follow the instructions in the README file, because per default, it's still the standard filter which is running. So you have to switch to your new one manually with your ground station.
Before Klaus, just to your video was covering the link to GitHub. So if you could, after this talk, copy paste the GitHub link in the chat.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'll do that. Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. Sorry. Please continue.
Yeah, thanks. So lastly, before concluding with the extension to the cooperative path planning approach we are aiming on in the next year, there are some potential pitfalls we come across. And the first one is referring to the Lighthouse system and the use case of applying the crossing beam method to get ground truth information. We found that it's really quite prone to any reflective material, and it means that even this comparably small scaled window is sufficient to cause distractions of your Lighthouse signal, which makes it impossible for any quantitative evaluation. So once you find this out, the solution is quite simple. You can just put something into this window area, and then you are ready to go. So this was the first thing we fell over. The second thing was some flow deck issues, especially with the standard filter. So this implementation in the Bitcrase master branch, actually, because we tried to transfer our GitHub code onto a customized drone based on the Bolt. And as you might note, the flow deck is mounted quite low, so there's a very low clearance between the surface and the flow deck. And this leads to divergence issues just before takeoff. So luckily before takeoff, so the Bolt actually refuses to take off. And this is something we have to handle with a new iteration, so enlarging the stance here to to guarantee more ground clearance for the flow deck. The same could also happen when you attach a flow deck underneath a modified LPS deck. So having both decks attached on the bottom side of your Crazy Fly, you will also have quite a low clearance for the flow deck. And again, this is an issue for the standard filter with the firmware. So please be aware of this. And we found out that it's even happening using these long deck connectors between this plastic area here has a larger thickness compared to the standard ones. And we got cases where we run into those divergence issues where we just use these long dock connectors together with a flow deck. So it might be interesting to know about it and not to write emails concerning any strange firmware behavior, which is what we did initially. Yeah, as a last outlook for what we are thinking of doing next, we'd like to extend the approach, the filter approach, towards cooperative navigation. So a scenario could be having Crazy Flies operating based on the Lighthouse system, but having an additional LPS deck attached to them, and below, maybe in some canyon of obstacles, there are some Crazy Flies operating based on the LPS system. And we hope that we could improve their navigation abilities by performing range measurements with the Lighthouse equipped Crazy Flies, either by TWR ranging, which has a higher accuracy, but also for other ones which are just passively listening to this communication here. And hopefully this information can be used within the filter to come up with a better quality of your navigation solution. Luckily, Bitcrase has already performed some steps towards it. So there's already an implementation of something which is called TDOA hybrid mode, which helps you quite a lot, helps us quite a lot in the beginning. However, there are a few challenges we have to overcome. So performing these range measurements, your navigation estimates will become correlated, and you have to account for these cross correlation during the estimation process, which is classically done applying something like covariance intersection or more modern approaches. However, we have to account for the limited computational resources on the crazy fly on one hand, and we have to care about a possibility to communicate these covariance information and also the estimated positions among our crazy fly team, which might also be something taking a while to implement. So that's basically what we are doing currently in the Cooperative Control Lab. Thank you very much for having this opportunity to introduce ourselves in the Crazy Flies community. And of course, happy birthday to the whole BitCraze team. And yeah, hopefully there will be lots of successful years following your first 10 years.